Welcome to 2021. Welcome to this new VulpesTheFox video. Let's talk about Gravity Rush 2. The game got developed by Team Gravity. That's one of Sony's Japan studio teams. And it got released by Sony in January 2017. As usual, I played with German interface and English voices. Wait, what? There is no dialogue to choose? Oh, okay. I played with German interface and voices. The game is set 3 years after the events of the original Gravity Rush, which I played as a remastered version on my PS4. So for me personally, it's very nice that there's a 3 years gap between the two games, because for me, I played the original Gravity Rush 3 years ago as well. So when they pick up in the story with the, it's been 3 years, I could relate to that. So we got introduced into the game through the sequence you saw in the beginning of this video. Our main character, Cat, who's a gravity shifter, so she can manipulate gravity, got into a dimensional portal with her friends Raven, who's a gravity shifter as well, and Sid, it's just a normal dude. So they got forced into the portal and there's no way back, and Raven is gone. So it's just Cat and Sid in this new unknown dimension. We got picked up by the banker settlement and worked there day for day to survive. The scene we saw in the beginning of this video is just an ordinary day for them to collect some ore to sell it later for exchange for food. Cat is no real gravity shifter anymore because she used to have a cat which gave her her powers. The name of the cat is Dusty, but Dusty the cat is lost too, so Cat is just basic human right now. These names though. So we start the game in a settlement, and you should already notice something, that the presentation style is like a mix of manga and anime. So the presentation style reminded me a lot of Final Fantasy 7 or something, like older games, where you see something on the screen but it's not that much detailed, and you have to figure out with the immersive style and your own thoughts, with the imagination, how it could be more detailed. On my mind there was way more going on as I saw on the screen, cause my mind was already working all the time, how the static scenes could live in my mind, if you understand what I mean. It's just imagination stuff. So we run around in the settlement and get some introduction to some characters, and in the first hour of the game the main plot gets to a point where we get Dusty back, our cat, and we are able to control gravity again. So Cat is able to control the gravity to kind of fly, do gravity kicks and throw objects around. There's a skill tree where we can level up our abilities, which is very nice. We pay the upgrades through gems we collect through the game, but it's the same stuff as the ore we collected in the beginning. So with our powers we can explore the first area of the game even more, and there are some tutorials unlocked or some side missions unlocked, and we can go down to the underground again like in the first scene of the game and collect the ore again, the gems to level up. So in this type of areas you don't need a suit anymore, and every area of this gem collecting areas is connected to a mission you can choose in the beginning. So there's a list of missions, and when you choose a mission you get to a specific area. So the missions are just some escort missions. There's even one boss fight, and it's very hard to beat this boss.
That's the wrong number!
So after you finish one mission, that you get a check mark on your mission list. But there's one very, very big problem. So just an example. If you finish mission A and you get a check mark at mission A, and you are like, oh nice, I got a check mark, let's go to the second mission. Let's go to mission B. After you finish mission B, you get a check mark at mission B. but the checkmark of mission A is gone. The game just sets a checkmark for the latest mission you have done. Even you have the other missions done and there's nothing more to explore, it's empty, it's still in the list like unfinished cause the checkmark is gone. And I was totally unsure, like, shall I do this again now? Is there something new? The checkmark is gone. I was like, huh? What? So I went back into one location and was like, okay, is here anything new? So I got into the area and there was a navigation point, there are enemies. And I was like, okay, let's beat the enemies. I beat all the enemies, and after I beat all the enemies, there's another navigation point to other enemies. And I was like, okay, let's beat these enemies as well. Maybe I get some reward or there's some new goal. I don't know. Maybe something evolves through it. After I beat the next enemies, nothing happens and there's a new navigation point to other enemies. And I was like, okay, let's try it. I tried. I really tried to solve this. I really tried to get something. Maybe there's something special hidden. Some item or some level up or some amount of gems. I couldn't see right now, but I just went through it and through it and through it. And I record all of the gameplay I do from my gaming reviews. I looked up how much of time I spent into this area. I was there 138 minutes. I was flying around in this area of the game where nothing happened. Just random spam of enemies. I kinda died like 5 times or something. There was nothing. There was nothing. And the game completely failed to communicate to me that there is nothing more to do. It's gone. It's done. Guys. If you look at the map, there are very, 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 very much islands. And they are not even all islands because the whole area is vertical as well. So it's get higher. So there could be 3 islands on top of each other. And I figured myself a plan out, like, if I clear every enemy camp of every island, I maybe get something. And there was nothing. I cleared nearly the whole map and was totally frustrated and lost at this point. So guys, if you're still up to play this game, just don't do these missions. They're not necessary at all. You don't need them. Just get them and play the main game. Don't get into these areas. It's very frustrating, distracting, and I was totally lost at this point. This 2 hours of frustrating, distracting stuff was the lesson for me. Like I mentioned in the last video, check it out if you didn't see it. But let's get all the rant aside and get to the sponsor of this video. What? What? We just got 16 subscribers? There is no sponsor? What should I do now? What should I do now? Okay. Guys, don't forget to subscribe to the channel and drop a like. So after all that stuff, the story goes on and there was a contest we had to win. But there was a snitch. I love that part. There was a snitch and the contest got totally invalid. So we had to figure out the winner of the contest for a melee fight.
Oh shit. Here we go again.
The whole setup and the intense gameplay totally hooked me over there. The story is so great and immersive. It's so dope. I really love this fight. Moments like this in a game where the focus changed so much are so good and my imagination just exploded over there. I really love these type of scenes. So after this great story scene, we get our first real open world moment of the game. But I really didn't like the way they did it. Cause there's a 5 second cutscene and then you get thrown into the world and the game is like, there you are, go. Guys, do I get any type of explanation, anything? That's it? But never mind, I really was hyped for the city and I just went to the marketplace and switched the gravity. It was very impressive how all the objects are flying around. So after that, I saw these gems again on the roofs of the city. I just wanted to get my pockets full and skill up fast. And that's why I collected all of them. But there is again one little tweak I didn't like. These gems are everywhere. They are
everywhere.
So the city we're in is split in multiple sections. And every section got its own multiple islands. And on every island, on top there are gems. And under the whole island, there are gems as well. So if you want to collect them all, you have to run through the whole map. Literally through the whole map you have to plan your time, like, okay, I got 1 hour to play now, I collect all the gems of the section. And it's just brainless farming. It's not that great though. Look at this gameplay. I just were collecting and collecting and collecting and collecting and collecting and collecting. And when I get into a new area or a new island or something, and I already saw these gems, I was like, oh no, not again, not again. I already did it like 5 hours in the past week. I don't want to spend the next 5 hours on collecting gems again. Cause that's one of the only resources where you get your gems. So guys, the topic collectibles was very huge in the last past 2 months for me. And I really would like to hear your opinion about it. So write a comment how you think about collectibles. Cause you can't do this. Look at this. So, and as I were flying around all these islands, I just questioned myself, like, what if I just let me drop into the ground and fall through the bottom? And there was another town, another section of the city. It was just totally mind-blowing for me, cause under the ordinary city, there's a whole other section where there's a slum and the people don't have any money or food, they're just suffering all the time and the whole mood changes, the color changes, and it was very mind-blowing for me as I experienced it without any communication again. I just experienced it on my own and it was just mind-blowing. So the people of the slums are stealing stuff from the rich people, which got way too much stuff. And talking about rich people, I asked myself, if I go down and there are the slums, what if I go up from the ordinary city point? I just found a rich people section where every family has its own island and mansion. And that's a very interesting point about this game. It's even a topic in the storyline. The gap between the rich people and the poor people. So let's talk about the activities you can do in this open world. At first, when you pause the game, there's a screen where you can look up all your activities, and the game even recommends activities to you. So the game tells you, like, hey, what about this challenge? Try this challenge. I think it's a really good idea to show players what the game has to offer. So aside activities, there are challenges, side quests, and small conversations. So let's talk about the challenges first. So there are racing challenges or fighting challenges, but you can even unlock more challenges later on in the game if you solve some side quests. So I solved all of the challenges because the reward for them are the gems you collect through the game to skill up your abilities. So that's really dope, and I like this activity. And there is one nice detail I like as well. Great. Let's go to the side quests. That's a hard topic. I try to keep it short. So the side quests really show you the mindset of the people, of the main story, of some random people in the city. You get to see every viewpoint of the city and of the characters. And that's a very interesting thing. So you interact with these people and you get to see the everyday struggle of these people and you really try to help them. And the game really has a huge rarity how to solve this missions. Every mission has another gameplay aspect and another storyline, so it's not duplicating itself that much. But it was a point where a special facade just broke, cause I spent more time with the side activities than with the main plot, and the main plot is about 20 hours, it's a huge main plot. And there are so many side quests. They are good, but it's way too many. And later on you get way too many of it and you're like, no, I don't wanna do them anymore. Then I got one very bad side quest. There was one very bad side quest. There were like 100 birds or something and I had to stealth through it to spy a couple, and it was so horrible. I tried it, so I was there for like a half hour at least at this one point. And I couldn't solve it. I just couldn't solve it. So I just got into a defense mode and just tried to finish the main story at one point. Cause the side quests are not rewarding in this game. There are a bunch of side quests. They are totally fine, but there are no rewards. And at some point you are like, why should I do them? If you hit a special amount of finished side quests, you get a health upgrade. A little one. You don't even get any kind of gems for the side quests. So you had to collect the gems in the city for hours to gain a little bit of chance to get upgrades. And that's a very bad point about this game. I don't like about it. And there's one special quest in this game where Sid, your companion, says, get this item and bring it to me. You get the item and bring it to him. And then he says, ah, nah, you have to get this item as well and bring it to me as well. Then you get the second item and bring it to him. Then he said, oh no, I have to get a third item. Bring it to me, please. Then you bring a third item to him. And then he said, oh no, I need to get a fourth item. Get an item and bring it to me, please. What is happening? That's bullshit. That's bullshit. It was trash. I really see that the game tries to save the quality of the side quest with the sense of humor and a little funny joke in the end of the side quest, but it's not worth it to spend like 20 minutes to do nothing. It's just like go from point A to B to A to C to A to D to A to E. The game has really a side quest like this and you get no reward for it. You just get no reward. Okay, I forgot something. You may get some filters as reward for your camera at the best case. That's it. And I shouldn't forget the game has a Super Mario reference with this character model. And that's really nice. So let's talk about the small conversations you can get. So these small conversations are there after every main quest and they are there to give you some background information, what happened in the city after the specific main quest. So NPCs tell you about the motivation of some characters and you get a clearer vision of the political way the city changed through the progression of the story. It's very smart, it's very useful, I really like that, but again, there's one problem. Imagine there are 5 options to get these conversations. And I already did like 4, and they disappear from the map. And if I die or restart the game or restart my console or anything, the 4 conversations I already done are back up there as new waypoints on the map. So the points on the map are back there and I have no view which conversations I already did and which I didn't. Cause it's like I never did them. I really try to like this game and I really like the conversations at all, but the game is so confusing. So let's talk about the main story quests. As always, I don't want to spoil you, but I'm just gonna tell you, you get some new gameplay mechanics through the storyline, which is really nice. So there's a lunar mode where Cat is way lighter than usual and she got like a moon-like gravity field and the attacks are weaker but way faster. And there's the opposite, there's the Jupiter mode where Cat gets very heavy and her attacks are very strong but very slow. So the power upgrades fit into the storyline cause there's a huge intensity later on and you don't know what happens next to the characters. You don't know what their destiny is and you really care for them. It's like, which character is going to die next? It's the enemy stuff, you know? But the story at all, for me personally, I had a wish how it would turn out. And it exactly happened how I wished it. So the story went to a point where I really liked it because it was everything I wished for the story. The game totally hooked me with its story later on. So it explained itself very good. What I didn't like about the story is that there are some gameplay fillers. And as other point, there are just a few cutscenes and you are like, okay, that's kind of low budget right now. But back to the gameplay, if you get a new mechanic in the game, like the Jupiter mode or the Lunar mode, you get some tutorial stone plates. Let's call it tutorial stone plates. Where like, oh, you got this new power. Fight 15 enemies with the power to go on your path. Something like this, you know? And you have to solve it and solve it and solve it. And the design of the whole area is great. Amazing. I love it. It's amazing. It's still a tutorial mission, you know? It's totally fine. It's totally fine over there. But way too often in the game, without any context, the game just pulls the, oh no, we don't have any budget left. Let's just get us some stone plates over there card. Way too often. It's repetitive, it's boring, it doesn't bring you any further. And so I ask myself, like, why has the game like 80 side quests and spams me full with side quests when the main story has filler material in it? There are way too many side quests for my feeling, and the main quest just got lack of quality. Why you don't combine those two things to a nice main quest? I don't get it. I just don't get it. For me personally, it's just bad game design and I really don't know why they did it like this. It could be a lack of budget, a lack of creativity, a lack of time, or they just wanted to have an argument like, we got this 20-hour main mission, main story, and we got like 80 side quests. I really love this game, but it's not perfect at any corner. it's not perfect anywhere. So as last point of this video, I just wanted to talk about the support of Gravity Rush 2 in general. Sony released Gravity Rush 2 in January 2017. And I don't know what happened, but 18 months after the official release, the server got shut down. So in the world there are some treasures you can find with some items in it, and you can photograph them and set them to a cloud where other players can get some hints where you can find these kind of treasure. Oh, the servers are down. For the challenges, there are worldwide rankings. Oh, the servers are down. You can get special outfits or even unique items or upgrades if you use the internet connection, but which internet connection? The servers are down. Team Gravity, the developer of this game, doesn't exist anymore. I mean, the people are there in the new development team, but they have not planned to do Gravity Rush 3. I mean, I don't need a Gravity Rush 3. I'm totally fine with Gravity Rush 2 and how they close the second part of the story. It's totally fine. But why do they drop the support of this game? Gravity Rush 2 was, at its time, a very large release for Sony, and they kinda never mentioned it again, and Sony kinda acts like the release of this game never happened. So there are no new copies of the game, there's no PlayStation Hits version of the game, the game doesn't get mentioned in any social media posts or something. But why? I don't get it. I mean, the game really has its flaws. I showed you them, but it's still way too underrated and way too much under the radar, you know? I do recommend this game if you are on vacation or something and you have time to spend to collect some gems for hours. I played it for like 45 hours and I got 0 bucks. And the soundtrack is amazing, by the way. Damn. The game has its own kind of magic to be loved, and it has its own soul, and that's beautiful. It's a beautiful game. And to the end, I just gotta say, see Spoiler! So we got picked up by the banger settlement. Banger. Banger. Banger.